Random House Audio presents Obama's Last Stand, Playbook 2012, by Glenn Thrush. Introduction by Evan Thomas. Read for you by Mike Chamberlain. Introduction, Evan Thomas. Over a half century ago, in a slower and more civil age, President Dwight Eisenhower barely campaigned for reelection. During the fall of 1956, Ike gave no more than a dozen campaign speeches, all high-minded stuff about peace and prosperity. He left it to his vice president, Richard Nixon, to attack the Democratic nominee, Adlai Stevenson. But even Nixon's rhetoric was tame in comparison to the vitriol of the modern campaign trail. While seeking a second term, President Eisenhower was not expected to get down in the trenches. He thought that partisan campaigning demeaned the presidency, and he knew that most voters wanted the president to stay above the fray. Eisenhower was supposed to concentrate on the big issues, standing up to the communist threat, building an interstate highway system, nurturing the world's biggest and most robust economy. Eisenhower was not afraid to call for sacrifice, a forbidden word in the poll-driven, consultant-dominated politics of today. In 2012, the political stage seemed so much smaller than it did during the Cold War era. The dispute seemed pettier and more evanescent. America is not nearly so self-confident as a nation, and politics reflects the sour, sometimes nasty quality of public debate. Taking a truly bold stand to restore American greatness does not seem to be within the power or vision of Barack Obama or Mitt Romney. Neither candidate has offered a plan to tame the looming national debt by raising taxes or cutting entitlements, or to rebuild America's infrastructure, or to reform political corruption by getting rid of loopholes and special favors for interest groups. Instead, Obama and Romney slam each other and allow their campaigns to run negative ads that are often, at best, half-truths. Obama's campaign seems unambitious and uninspired for a man who won the presidency 4 years ago by promising hope and change. Obama was not insincere in 2008. He is the sort of man who dreams of a better world. Indeed, he is sometimes regarded as too dreamy, off in the clouds, aloof from the tug and pull of political life. The image of Obama as high-minded thinker tells only half the story, however. Anybody who has watched him play pickup basketball knows another Obama. His jump shot may be shaky, but he plays hard, relentlessly, to win. As Politico's Glenn Thrush shows in the narrative that follows, Obama is fiercely competitive. He is not the sort of president who thinks, "Well, I did my best. I can do no better." He wants victory, and he is willing to play hard and rough to stay in the Oval Office for 4 more years. This is the third installment of Politico's ebook on the 2012 election. The first two covered Romney and the race for the GOP nomination, and a fourth, to be published after the election, will take an inside look at the fall campaign. Earlier Obama biographers, including David Marinus, David Remnick, and Jonathan Alter, have discerned the psychological roots of Obama's drive. Indeed, Obama himself revealed them in Dreams from My Father, the fatherless boy competing with the ghost of a man who was never there for him. Throughout his youth and young adulthood, Obama struggled with loneliness and a sense of dislocation, of not quite belonging. He was trying to fit in while just as earnestly trying to maintain his independence, trying to be one of the guys, but also exceptional. The way for an outsider to be an insider was to win. Obama's ambition knew few boundaries. He saw early success as the first black editor of the Harvard Law Review who climbed to the tip-top of the meritocratic elite. Elected to the U.S. Senate at the age of 43, he was immediately recognized as a contender for the ultimate political prize. Having attained it, Obama, unsurprisingly, is damned if he is going to give it up. Competitiveness is a presidential trait. Even the loftiest statesmen in the Oval Office have kept an eye on the ballot box. It is one of the redeeming qualities of American political life. You have to earn election by putting yourself before the people. Dwight Eisenhower did not run very hard for reelection in 1956. For one thing, he was busy trying to avoid a nuclear confrontation over twin crises in Hungary and the Suez Canal. But that doesn't mean that on election night he wasn't fiercely determined to win big. At noon on election day, Eisenhower had told the British Prime Minister, Anthony Eden, "I don't give a damn how the election goes." He was feigning indifference. That night, as Ike waited for the state-by-state returns, he said to his speechwriter, Emmett Hughes, "When I get in a battle, I just want to win the whole thing." Hearing that he was ahead by a landslide, Eisenhower compared himself to Admiral Lord Horatio Nelson, who, as he lay dying after his triumph at the Battle of Trafalgar, asked if there were any French ships left that had not sunk or surrendered. Eisenhower wanted to win every state. He ultimately took 41 of 48. Obama would settle for a narrower margin of victory. But he is no less determined. Obama's Last Stand. Barack Obama had just arrived for a fundraiser at a hotel in Coral Gables, Florida, a soaring sandstone pile of roaring 20s opulence that had once attracted the likes of Bing Crosby, Al Capone, and FDR. The date was February 23, 2012, and Obama was in town to collect $4 million at a trio of big money events. Sprung from the Oval Office, out on the trail, he was in a lighthearted, fighting mood. A few weeks earlier, the GOP primary had rolled out of town, and to Obama, the results, a decisive win for Mitt Romney, mattered less than the relentless Republican attacks on his record. He hated being on the sidelines. Peering into the sea of faces, Obama spied an old friend, a local Republican activist. The woman, Obama knew, was close to Florida's charismatic junior senator, Marco Rubio, at the time considered to be the most dangerous potential number two on the GOP ticket in November. The incumbent flashed the toothy, expansive grin he uses to defuse conflict, deliver a zinger, or issue a friendly warning. "So, is your boy going to go for it?" Obama asked, loud enough for someone nearby to hear. The woman certainly wasn't expecting this sort of welcome. But she had seen this side of Obama before, the puckish trash talker, not the professor who delivered high-minded lectures to eye-rolling senators. "I don't know. It could happen," the woman said with a laugh. Obama's smile widened, eyes twinkled and narrowed. The president craned in even closer, hand on her shoulder, Obama's characteristic gesture of playful confrontation, as his retinue of Secret Service agents scanned the area and aides fidgeted over their folders and schedule sheets. "Well," he said, chuckling, "tell your boy to watch it. He might get his ass kicked." The hundreds of thousands who packed his rallies in 2008, even the staffers who still worshipped him, seldom got to see this side of Obama. But the opposition did. This was the competitor come down from the clouds. So did the small circle of advisors, the dozen or so diehards whom he trusted most, who rode Obama's competitiveness to a historic victory in 2008. And they knew he would need that competitive fire even more in 2012. Running against John McCain and Hillary Clinton wasn't as intimidating as the challenges Obama would be facing this time. Obama's last stand, almost certainly the final campaign of his life, would be waged against a host of foes: Romney, Republican super PACs, and most dangerous of all, an implacable economic downturn, one he had been elected to reverse 4 years earlier. Obama's will to win everything he undertakes is not an element of his personality that he tends to emphasize. Biographers, led by Obama himself, have been more enamored with his complexity, his commitment to elevating American politics. But he also seeks shallower waters, especially in times of crisis. Half the flat screens in the West Wing were tuned to ESPN. Beating his former body man, Reggie Love, at pool could put him in a good mood all day. He'd blow a gasket, get really angry, his friends told me, if he suspected one of his companions was intentionally blowing a gimme putt or a layup to placate the boss. He wanted to beat his opponent on the level. There didn't even have to be a real game for him to compete. Once, standing backstage before a speech at a school, a bored Obama noticed Love tossing a ball at a tiny square made out of masking tape on the cinder blocks. He grabbed the ball and challenged Love to see who could get the most balls inside the square. Best out of 10, Reggie, he said. Most of Obama's senior staffers maintained that quotidian scheduling issues delayed for weeks a long-planned round of golf with Speaker of the House John Boehner in the summer of 2011. But others close to Obama sensed another reason for the holdup. Procrastination.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Playbooks, use the link in the video description.